Welcome to our next module in biostatistics. This is our module where we will be exploring a variety of different inferential statistics. We've looked at a few already, and we're going to be expanding on your knowledge of hypothesis testing and that sort of thing. To get us started, I'd like for you to think about the whole concept of selecting the right test. And with this particular concept, conceptually, you cannot pick the right test to perform in statistics unless you know your level of measurement for each of the variables. And so this table helps to summarize some of the things that we've learned so far. First of all, in terms of level of measurement, that's over here on the left-hand side. And a dichotomous variable has two values, a nominal variable has three or more values, an ordinal scale with limited values, and we've talked about that, has three to seven values, and they are in some kind of inherent order. This would be like a Likert scale and that kind of thing. And then we have interval ratio, which means that the difference between each of the units is evenly spaced, and it usually has a unit of measurement. These other two that are grayed out, we will not be covering for this particular quarter. We talked a little bit about the box and whiskers plot, median range, interquartile range, and some things like that, but we won't be covering the bivariate analysis for those. So our main focus areas are the unshaded blocks. Now, if you know your scale of measurement, then that helps you to select the right univariate analysis that you would do, one variable at a time, uni being one. And so for any of your categorical variables, which would be dichotomous, nominal, and ordinal, we would make a bar graph, and we would make, for in terms of numerically, we would count, in other words, the frequency or the N, and then the percent of the total for each category. If we have an interval ratio variable, then of course we would make a histogram and calculate the mean and some kind of measure of variance or standard deviation, that kind of thing. How, where it's located, which is the mean, and the standard deviation, how far spread apart it is. So that's a quick review and sort of an orientation to this table. Also, in terms of bivariate analysis, which is our focus for winter quarter, you have already learned three different statistical tests. Two of them are chi-square tests, the chi-square goodness of fit test and the chi-square test of independence. You've also learned a specific case where we would use Fisher's exact test. And if you orient yourself to this graph, you can see what these, how this is laid out. Any variable that is categorical and is just one sample, one variable compared to some expected value in the population would be a chi-square goodness of fit. Anytime you have that same situation where you have a categorical variable and you're either seeing if that is independent or related to another categorical variable, which could be dichotomous, nominal, or ordinal again, that would be your chi-square test of independence. And only in this very special case where you have dichotomous by dichotomous do you have a Fisher's exact test. And so that's the way we can think about the different tests that you have learned so far. The next step that we'll need to make is to kind of create a roadmap of where exactly we'll be going for the rest of this quarter. And what I've done inside of these boxes is I've put the different lesson numbers, lesson 2, lesson 3, lesson 4, lesson 5, and lesson 6, in terms of when we'll be covering the different tests. However, today you are going to be learning all of the names of the tests, so that you would be able to at least select the right test even if you're not sure yet how to run that in SPSS. So let's go ahead and get started with this. I'm going to start over here with lesson 2. And what you'll notice all of a sudden is instead of being limited to just these categorical variables, see how we're in chi-square and the Fisher's exact, the only kind of variable we're ever dealing with are dichotomous, nominal, or ordinal. None of these have a situation where we are including an interval or ratio variable. So this next module is where we are going to be expanding into the range of interval ratio variables or continuous variables. So in lesson two, we'll be covering something called simple linear regression. I'm going to abbreviate it here so that it fits neatly in the box. So SLR stands for simple linear regression. And you'll notice that in the case of simple linear regression, we, for our bivariate, bi meaning two, we have two variables. One of them is an interval ratio variable, and the other one is also an interval ratio variable. So both variables for simple linear regression are interval ratio variables. The other part of simple linear regression is Pearson correlation. So I'm going to go ahead and put that on here. And Pearson correlation really is the effect size for simple linear regression. And so those are the two tests. There really are just two different ways of thinking about the same thing, where we have two interval ratio variables, and we're showing how those two are related. So a simple relationship that would be an example of this would be height and weight. If we know a person's height, then we may know something also about what they're more likely to weigh. If they're shorter, they're probably more likely to weigh less. And if they're taller, they're more likely to weigh more. And so that's kind of the relationship between those two variables. The next lesson we'll be learning is lesson three, and we'll be learning two different tests. And that is going to be our independent t-test and something called one-way ANOVA. And so we have these two different scenarios where we have an interval ratio variable, but the second variable of the bivariate, remember here we have two variables, the second one is either a dichotomous variable, so here we have dichotomous variable by interval ratio, or we have something that has three or more values, and this would be either the nominal or ordinal scale with limited values, and that's when this independent t-test expands and we get to have a one-way ANOVA test. And so, for example, if we want to see if, for the dichotomous, if men and women have the same average, let's say men and women have the same average cholesterol, that would be an independent t-test. But if we wanted something that had three different categories, say students at three different schools, if we wanted to see if they have the same average amount of sleep, say, and so sleep in hours, and then here we have our three different schools, that would be called a one-way ANOVA. And I'll be saying this in the future again, so you don't have to remember it now, but really an independent t-test is just a special case of a one-way ANOVA that only has two categories. And so this has three or more. It's very flexible. It's able to do a lot of things. We can make that simplified by just having two categories and call that an independent t-test. We don't have as much to think about. Our next lesson, which is lesson four, is going to include a couple of different things. One of them is a paired, if I can spell, t-test. And this is called a one-sample t-test. And those two are very much related. Just like the independent t-test and the one-way ANOVA are very much related to each other, the one-sample t-test and the paired t-test are also very related. And in the one-sample t-test, just like we did in the chi-square goodness of fit, we are taking some kind of a continuous variable, and we're comparing it to an expected or a population value. And so we may wonder if the average height for a population is, say, 5'6". And so we really only are measuring one variable, just like we did in the chi-square goodness of fit. However, it's an interval ratio variable instead of being a categorical variable. So we've seen something like this before, just now we're dealing with interval ratio variables. The other one is new to us, and this is where we have paired measurements. In other words, we take that same measurement, like let's say we take height at the beginning of first grade and height at the beginning of second grade for the same group of people, and we pair it. It makes a difference if how tall a child was to start with, and that may influence how tall they are at the end. And so a lot of times we think of this paired measurement as a pre and post. It doesn't have to be that way. We can have other kinds of pairings, but that's the simplest way to think about that. So that would be called a paired t-test. So that gets us through lessons two, three, and four. For lesson five, we're simply taking this simple linear regression and we're turning it into what we call a multivariate analysis. Here we were looking at bi, which means only two variables at a time. With multivariate or multivariable analysis, we can have multiple predictors, not just one kind. We can have dichotomous and nominal and interval ratio, lots of different predictors of a continuous outcome. And so what we do is instead of calling that simple linear regression, we call that multiple linear regression. I'm abbreviating it here again, MLR. And we, instead of having Pearson correlation, we have a larger view of what that correlation really looks like. And so here's our multiple linear regression. This is where we get into all kinds of confounders and effect modifiers, and we're thinking about model building. So this is really where a lot of the research happens, is where we're adjusting for multiple different things in our model. So that's our multiple linear regression. And then the final analysis that we're looking at is kind of like we drop back down to our categorical, but we remain in this multivariate analysis. So we have multiple predictors. They could be dichotomous, nominal, interval ratio. There could be 8 or 10 of them. So any combination with these multiple predictors. However, now instead of having an interval ratio outcome, like our multiple linear regression, we have a dichotomous outcome. So this is where we call it logistic regression. And so we have multiple linear regression and we have logistic regression. And so two very powerful tools, depending on what kind of outcome we have, if it's continuous or dichotomous, we have a way to analyze our data either way. And so very often we will go through this process where we think about the level of measurement. We perform univariate analysis to get a sense of our data for all of our variables. And then we'll look at some kind of bivariate analysis, whatever our two main variables are, whether we're doing some kind of a t-test or a NOVA or a chi-square. And then we progress from there to either multiple linear regression or to logistic regression. And so don't worry if you didn't capture everything, because we're going to go over some specific examples for each one of these. For simple linear regression, one-way ANOVA, independent t-test, the paired t-test, one-sample t-test, multiple linear regression, and logistic regression. So we'll be looking at all of those different scenarios in our next video.